In so many ways, the days of the pioneers and the homestead lifestyle are very romanticized. But for those of us who grow up in towns and cities, who are used to having electricity and running water and refrigerators, what would it really be like to return to a simple way of life, throwing all of those things away and truly going off the grid? Today we've traveled to a beautiful property here in Missouri to find out.
Hey,
Doug.
Hey.
How are you?
Good to meet you, mate.
How are you?
Hi, Stacy.
Hey.
Lovely to meet
you. Good to meet you, too.
This place is just so peaceful, isn't it?
Yeah, it's nice and quiet.
We love it. We just love it. We just had a beautiful rain, and it's very calm, and the birds are out, and it's been great.
It really is. This place, I mean, I feel like I've just come back in time.
Don't let the clothes fool you.
Living the pioneer lifestyle in the 21st century right here.
You really are. Tell me a little bit about this land and how you came to be here.
So basically, we left the city 7 years ago, and we decided that we wanted to slow down our life a little bit, more fresh air, and grow our own food so we'd be in more control of our health and nutrition and stuff like that. So the search began to find about a 10-acre lot of land. And, you know, it's been working really well for us.
Now, you built your own home from scratch.
Yeah.
You're growing a lot of your own vegetables and food here. Had you ever done anything like this before?
Yeah, that's the question we get a
lot.
All the
time, yeah.
And when we left, we were total city slickers. So we had never really had a garden, and I had never really built anything. I've been in sales my whole life, so, like, you know, that's the kind of atmosphere I came from. I had a couple of businesses, and we sold those and moved out here, and this was the first big project I tackled. When we bought the property, the only thing on it was the large barn, the green and white barn, where we harvest our rainwater. And then I slowly began. I built this cabin in 90 days with no experience.
Yeah, because he had to get it done before winter.
Yeah.
It was like he started in July, and it was like October he finished it.
Yeah, plus we were separate. I was living in a tent here on the property with the dogs, and she was in this one-bedroom apartment. We actually transitioned from our 3,000-square-foot house into a one-bedroom apartment just to kind of get a feel for living tiny. And then that's when we moved out here.
And that was a shock. 5 bedrooms, 3 baths to this little bitty apartment. Mm-hmm. It was crazy. But it helps you to downsize and then to get out here and to do what we're doing. So it's been wonderful. Very cathartic.
So one of the questions that we do get a lot often is, why did we do this? Like, who wants to live? Actually, even the Amish can't even understand it. When we first moved out here, they were like, what are you guys doing? Everyone wants to go to the electricity in the city, and you guys are going the complete opposite way.
They even bet on us that we would make it a year, and we go back to them now, it's been 7 years, and they, I mean, they totally respect us for it, but they literally did, even though they don't bet, but they didn't think we could make it a year.
But we just wanted to reduce our consumerism and our footprint and just be more in control of our lives. You know, people co-opt out everything. You send your kids to school, you go to the store to get your food, you put gas in your car. I mean, we have a horse and a horse and buggy. We grow most of our own food. We heat with wood that we harvest ourselves. And so all that stuff, just
catch our rainwater,
just made us feel more complete to be back on the land and to be doing things like our forefathers did.
So this is very, very different from your past life in the city.
Yeah.
What was that transition like?
Oddly enough, I don't think it was really that big of a deal. I mean, we went from all electricity and appliances and a fridge and touch everything and turn the thermostat.
Buy.
Right.
Consume. You know, now we produce it all. We do it all. We are everything. What do you always say?
I'm the hay man. There used to be a skit back on one of the old comedy TV shows, and it was the hay man. He'd sweep the floor, answer the phone. You know, so out here, like, I'm the builder, the electrician, the plumber, the gardener, the...
Yeah, and I'm the producer with, you know, instead of going to the grocery store as much, I mean, I'm doing everything myself.
Mm-hmm.
So, I mean, it's one of those things. It's very rewarding. I mean, it's so awesome to know that we're doing this and we can take care of ourselves and we can shut the gate and we can just live and not have to worry about a thing.
Quite often on the show, we talk about being off the grid. You are really off the grid here, aren't you? I mean, you have no electricity.
Right.
Your running water is just gravity fed, no pumps, anything like that.
No pumps, no power, no problem.
Right.
Yeah.
Very, very simplistic way of life.
Right.
How is that working out?
It's been working fantastic. I mean, really, we haven't missed a beat. We're in the Midwest, so it gets really hot and humid here. So, Yeah, you'll long for the air conditioning a little bit. We might spend extra hours at Walmart or but I, you know, everyone's different. Like, we've reduced our carbon footprint. We sleep better with our circadian rhythms, like we're up with the sun, we go to bed with the moon.
Right.
You know, we just feel better, we have more energy.
We're in tune with nature. I mean, that's just a huge, huge area there, because, you know, listen to the animal sounds, and then we're very aware of the weather patterns, what's going on, you know, the wind, the north winds, south winds. I mean, I knew nothing about winds, where the sun is, where the moon. I mean, I'm really in tune with everything going on, and that's a powerful thing. I mean, it's amazing in how it's changed our whole lives.
And the rainwater has been fantastic. In our area, we get about 40 inches of rain a year. So really, that's not a problem for us. We have 3,000 gallons rainwater catchment system that gravity feeds here, and we have two hydrants in the yard for the animals in the garden. And every building on our property also collects water. Like, there's 500 gallons here, 500 gallons on our greenhouse. So every building is self-sufficient.
One of the immediate things that I notice about the way that you've set all of this out is that you've got your wonderful cabin, but then you've got all of these other outbuildings. Can you tell me a little bit about the setup here?
So basically, like in our area too, there's a place you can go to. It's the Daniel Boone home. And we did a lot of research, and also we have an Amish community that's kind of close by us. And what we found was that even back in the pioneer days, they would have their home central for sleeping. And then outside of that, they'd have a lot of outbuildings for smoking meat, for chickens, for outdoor kitchen, for cooking in the summer. And that's what we mimicked. And often we find places that try to do this, but they put everything really far,
so
away.
Far away.
We're getting older every day. We can't stop it. So we don't want to have chores, you know, like, we have 11 acres. I don't want to put something 2 acres away.
Way far away. You know, we want to make it close enough where I can just, and then the other thing that's great is we can see everything. We kind of have that eagle eye. So I can just look out at our property and I can see the chickens. Our garden's right there. Mm-hmm. I can just walk to it. And that's what I do. I'll cut up and get our salad. I bring a big bowl out. I get our, you know, what we're going to have for dinner. Just walk out in the garden. So it's been great.
There's this definite dream that so many people have of self-sufficiency. Is that what you're striving for here?
Yeah. I mean, I don't think, you know, like, no one can be absolutely self-sufficient. But I think the more control you take back, you know, enables you to live a more fulfilling life, is how we feel. I mean, everyone has their different walk, right? So we feel that, you know, we're providing for our own food. You know, if you're conscious about global warming or the environment, what better way to do it than to grow food and then bring it right into your table, right? There's no bags for transport. There's no petrol for going to the store. I mean, none of that stuff.
Like, you, I love it. He always says this. We don't have a bill, right?
Right. I don't even have a mailbox, so we don't have any bills. We don't even know who Bill is.
Yeah.
Right. Mm-hmm.
Tell me about building this house.
It was quite an adventure. We dragged the wood out of the forest. I had it sawmilled at a local sawmill. I did a little research about how the ends would go together, you know, the joinery. So we decided on a saddle notch joinery, and it's very simplistic. And one of the things that really stuck with me is that if the pioneers did it, and most of them couldn't even read and write, we could do it. So that's what we did. Only thing I subbed out on this build was the concrete. We have a crawl space underneath there, and I'd never done that before, so we did sub that out, but everything else I built myself.
And what about the design?
That was kind of weird too. We just kind of put a box on paper, almost like a tiny house, right? But a lot of people use SketchUp because there's a lot of intricate parts. You have drywall and you have the walls and how everything's going to go together. But with this kind of a structure, we have no drywall, no interior walls. It's all just a box, and then another box on the back for the back room, and then upstairs we just had to figure out the pitch, and then we built the rafters in place, and, you know, everything just went on.
And they're very thick. Yeah. I mean, you can't even get a nail through the wood.
Oh, well, it's white oak.
Yeah, it's white oak, and it is pretty tough.
So what's in between the logs here? Is that like a kind of clay render you've got in there? Or?
Yeah, it's called chinking. This actual stuff is called log jam. It comes in like a tube. And the reason why we went with that is it was pretty much the best stuff they offer, like, for today's technology. And it expands and contracts very well with the changing seasons.
And I can see there's a little bit of a construction project going on right now. You're building a root cellar, right?
Yeah, it's been a busy year. We put a deck on the back of the house after 7 years. We also built an outdoor shower, which has been really nice.
Which is wonderful.
And now we're working on food storage, because when we're out here, we don't have a refrigerator, really. We use a 100-year-old refrigerator, but we're trying to even move a little more independent. I'm building a root cellar right now on the other side of the house. It's down about 9 feet, and we did it with ICF foam. So it's going to have a R value of about 50. And so it's really going to keep it cool in there, maybe in the mid to upper 40s. And I think that's really going to be a win.
Well, I absolutely love what you've done here, and I would really like to see inside the
yeah,
house.
Yeah, come on in.
All right, come on in.
All right. Wow, this is really charming.
Yeah, we really enjoy the space. That's the nice thing about it, you know?
I just love how natural everything feels as well. It just has that, truly that kind of pioneer feeling, isn't
it? Yeah, and that was one of the things that were important to us is keeping everything natural. Aside from the wood cook stove that's made from metal, everything in here is wood or leather, you know, just natural ingredients from the earth. And
yeah, basically just to get all the toxins out. I wanted everything as natural as we could so we wouldn't be breathing any of that stuff. Yeah. So that was huge, huge for us.
So what size is the home?
So it's basically under 600 square feet.
And the kitchen, I mean, this is really just beautiful. It looks like it wants to be cooked in. I love the wood stove. This is such a nice feature.
Yeah, one of our main food preservations that we use, you know, a lot of people that do the homesteading thing or that, you know, they do canning. And so we're into fermenting because we would like to eat live food. Fermenting lasts 6 months to a year.
Easy. Right.
So it'll carry us over until the next harvest.
So what is your number one tip for designing the ultimate homestead kitchen?
Bigger counter space.
Yeah, and then you need to have a good, I mean, honestly, because you're doing so much preparing, you do have to get, when we first started, we did have a wooden
top. Wood.
When we went ahead and got the Cambria quartz top, this has been amazing. I just wish it was a little bit bigger, mm-hmm. but the more counter space that you have, I mean, that's where it's at. And then this has been, I love this thing. I love my Pioneer Princess. It's a wood cook stove. Right now it's summertime, so I have it covered, but we use this. I mean, I use it. I have water boiling all the time. I can cook, and actually it's the center when people come over. I mean, this is like the center of attention for everybody, and it's a great place. I can warm things, and in the summertime, it's my storage. I can put my ferments and things on there. So, I mean, this is just amazing. So if I had my wood cook stove and a little bit more counter space and some good stainless steel bowls, I got it going on.
And oddly enough, we have some sourdough starters from the Pioneer Trail.
150 years old.
Wow.
Yeah, she actually got that. Where was that?
At Baker Creek.
Yeah, at Baker Creek. We did a spring planting festival there and someone brought it to her.
Fantastic.
I love the stories behind stuff like that.
Yeah, not everyone can be having 150-year-old sourdough.
No, no. Went across in a covered wagon.
How about that?
Yeah.
And what a beautiful living room. One of the things that it's impossible not to notice in here is that there is not a single light switch, not a single light. It's all kerosene lamps and candles. This must just be so cozy at night.
It is.
It's very romantic. It does. It's great. I mean, it does set your circadian rhythms, you know, as you sit down and the sun starts going down, it does help your body to relax. Mm-hmm. You know, we're so inundated with light,
the
you know, from the computers and all that. I mean, it's very good for your body to kind of set your mood to help you sleep better.
Makes perfect sense, doesn't it?
Yeah, it's kind of weird.
Strange that. And what do we have through here?
So this is our back room. And we have an all-cedar chest here. She just got that. I designed it to fit in the corner, and then I had a local craftsman actually make it for us.
It is beautiful.
And it's cedar, and it's been great. It's my pantry, so I keep all of my stuff in there. And I didn't have a pantry for all these years, and so it's been great to kind of get all the stuff off the shelves and the corners, so now I can store all my things in here.
And then it's like a little mini apothecary that you've got over there in the corner, isn't it?
It is, where I can stir my potions and all that, right? It's been great. So when he goes and he shaves or whatever, I have everything there, and I have two little candles there if it's dark or in the morning.
So you just bring a bowl over?
Yeah.
Fantastic.
Yeah. Just like the old days.
Just like the old days.
A pitcher in a bowl.
Yeah, with some hot water. He puts his razor in it, and then there he goes.
You know, a lot of people wonder about that. They're, you know, so what happened was 7 years ago when we decided to do this lifestyle, I decided to quit shaving.
And I always loved beards. Yeah. He always kind of had a goatee, and I just always loved beards. And I always wanted him to grow a beard, and he never really liked the beard because food would get in his face.
Well, the mustache.
Yeah, the mustache.
So that's why I don't have a mustache. There's really no other reason behind it. But man, have you been out there buying those razors? They're expensive. So that was a major thing that we cut out of our thing. I was going through razors like maybe 3 or 4 a week or something.
He's really hairy.
Shaving. I mean, that really helped the budget just by cutting out that. Now I just, you know, do this and I'm done. And I mean, a razor lasts me now like months.
And then the composting toilet there?
Yeah, we use the composting toilet. It's basically the sawdust method. Inside of there is a 5-gallon bucket. And then we take that outside and I built a composting bin. It's basically a 2-year cycle. You use this buckets, you put them into a pile, you wait a year, and then after that, you can use it on trees, shrubs, even your garden.
And then your bathtub is full of potatoes.
This is our temporary root cellar. Last year we kept potatoes in here all year, and it worked out fine, you know. So now we'll have a root cellar, so it'll be transferred over. And then we'll use this bathtub, since we're having outdoor shower over there and a new shower spot over here, we'll be using this for something else on the homestead.
And should we take a look upstairs?
Yeah, that's our loft area. That's where our bedroom is. And this is our pull-up bar here. It's where we do our pull-ups, and Stacy uses it to stretch out.
Yeah, and you can do pull-ups. It's good stuff.
So we just finished all this off with cedar up here.
It smells so heavenly.
It really does.
And we have a cedar bed. You know, everything's handmade. Our furniture is all handmade by local carpenters, and this bed is handmade as well.
So you've been here now on this property for the last 7 years. How are you really finding this way of life?
Wouldn't change it.
It gets better. It gets easier every year. I mean, I guess after the fourth year, it really, because everything started going together. Because, mm-hmm. You know what you want. You try to make things a little bit more easier, I guess.
Yeah.
And
develop your systems.
Yeah, you get your systems. But we've changed a lot of things, too, mm-hmm. to find out, you know, some things maybe didn't work as well. So it's been good. It just gets better and better and easier and easier. It's just like second nature now.
And now when we go to the city, because, you know, we do speaking engagements and stuff. We're traveling. And that stuff kind of is like, you know, you can really kind of feel that
energy. I miss
energy.
My rainwater. Yeah. Like if you go someplace, there's a big difference, you know, when you take a shower.
Oh, for sure.
Wash your face, or like I'm doing dishes on my hands and skin. I miss the rainwater. I just miss the air.
Yeah, nature.
Yeah, nature. I mean, yeah. It's crazy. It's just like something's pulling at me to be back out here.
A project like this, it's very unusual. But do you have any idea what the cost of achieving all this has been?
We've made a lot of improvements in the 7 years, right? So, but when we first got here, bare bones, it was under $15,000.
And that was for the house.
Right.
Right.
That was for the logs, you know, to have milled and the foundation that I subbed out, the concrete, and then everything else I basically built myself. So that's just the wood that we used for the pier, the plywood, you know, the roofing material. You know, all that kind of a stuff. So we wanted to make sure we stayed debt free. So we paid for our property, we paid for our building, everything we have, we don't owe anybody any money for. So that was a huge thing for us. We didn't want to feel enslaved to that. So if we wake up in the morning and we don't feel like doing anything, we don't do anything. You know, we don't have anybody rattling our chain about it, you know?
Yeah, because people can't understand. It's like, you know, you're not working and, you know,
right.
I'm only working maybe a couple days a week. You know, how can you do it? But we don't have any bills.
Yeah.
We don't have to pay any bills. So it's been great.
The rat wheel has been disassembled.
Yeah.
Well, your home is beautiful, your land is beautiful, and your whole way of life is beautiful. Thank you both so much
for
sharing.
Thanks
for
coming out.
Yeah, thanks, Bryce.
Thank you. With a lot of dedication and hard work, Doug and Stacy have truly created a paradise here in this place that really is almost like a little bit of solace from the hectic modern world. For some people, this might look like living in the past, but as we start to rediscover the importance of nature and our place in it, to me, I think this looks a lot like our future.